So, good evening, all of you. I hope I am audible and visible to everyone. Please give me a thumbs up. So, good evening, Shatrughan. Welcome to this session. Today, I will be discussing a very, very important topic, and that is the three trips which you should know for your exam and which is very important to crack your MCQs for vesiculobullous disorders. So, everyone, welcome to this session. And today, before starting the today's session, a little bit about the Unacademy platform. So, first of all, this is Unacademy Let's Crack It NEET PG YouTube channel, which is one of the best platform for the NEET PG preparation. I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your NEET PG educator, and I will mainly teach you the dermatological aspect of your NEET PG preparation. Now, you all should be aware that in dermatology or from dermatology, you will get around 12 questions to 13 questions in your NEET PG exam, which is a very, very good number. Now, why we are reading dermatology? Because in dermatology, the 13 questions which usually comes are very easy to crack. The topics are also very common and frequently asked topics. So it is very easy to take care of those 13 questions, which can be the rank deciding factors for all of you in your NEET PG preparation. Okay, so I have myself scored All India rank 261 in my exam, and that is why I will give you the tips and tricks which I have used to crack my exam. Now, little bit about Unacademy. It is the online platform for the preparation of NEET PG. You can get this app on your app store. Just type Unacademy Learning app, install the app. Now, after downloading the app, you have two type of subscriptions on Unacademy. One is Plus and another is Iconic. From Plus subscription, you can get an access to all the live classes, live test, batch courses, and structured schedule. So if you are planning to give your NEET PG exam in 2021, Plus subscription is best for you because you can get all the things which is required for your last moment revision. Now, if you are planning to give your next pattern exam in 2022, I will suggest to take Iconic subscription. Now, why Iconic for 2022? Because Iconic gives you access to two best online platforms in our country, that is Unacademy and PrepLadder. So you can have access to both these with the help of Iconic subscription. For Iconic, one year subscription is 55,000 rupees. But if you use my referral code, which is Cheshta10, you can have the same subscription in 49,500. So you will get additional discount on using my referral code on the Iconic subscription. Similar to that, if you are choosing the Plus subscription, the 1 month subscription is around 5,000 rupees, but you can get the same subscription in 4,500. Again, the same thing if you use my referral code. So requested everyone to please get this subscription and use my referral code Cheshta10 for your subscription. So please give me a thumbs up if everyone is ready for the today's class, a very, very important session, that is the three tips or tricks to solve the questions of vesiculobullous disorders. So everyone, you all are welcome for this session. Now, starting with the first question. Now, how will you get the questions from vesiculobullous disorders, which includes pemphigus vulgaris, pemphigus foliaceus, bullous pemphigoid? So, giving you an idea, I want everyone to please answer this question. Shatrughan and all the other students who are live in my session, please answer this question. A 50-year-old female presents with a history of erosion in the buccal mucosa and blisters on her upper chest. On examination, bullae are flaccid filled with clear fluid, which is the clinical diagnosis. So, can anybody answer this question? Anyone can answer this question? Shatrughan, can you answer this question? So, here now I will give you the three tips which is required. Coming to the first tip, very nice, Vijay, you are absolutely right. The correct answer here is pemphigus vulgaris. Very nice, Vijay, Rajat, and Mahima, you all three are right for this condition. Now, how to solve these type of questions? The tip number one is what type of bulla? Now, if you see this question, they have given you that patient presents with flaccid bulle. So first thing which you should remember is what type of bulla do you see in that question? This is trick number one. There are two type of bulle which are seen. These are flaccid bulle and tense bulla. Flaccid bulle means that you have intraepidermal acantholytic disorder, while tense bulla means you have subepidermal acantholytic disorder. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood this point. Vijay, Rajat and Mahima, what is the trick number one? What type of bulla is this, flaccid or tense? If they have given in the question flaccid, it means that you are dealing with an intraepidermal acantholytic disorder. But if it is tense like this, it should be a subepidermal type of acantholytic disorder. Now, what are the different examples of intraepidermal and subepidermal? That is the tip number two. What is the level of split? So the intraepidermal and subepidermal. Intraepidermal means you have, in intraepidermal, you have level of split inside the epidermis. Now it can be at three places. What are those three places? Subcorneal, which means that just below the stratum corneum. So intraepidermal includes subcorneal. The second one is spinous cell layer. And the third one is suprabasal or basal layer. I request everyone to remember it like this. This is very, very important. Trick number one, what type of bulla? And trick number two, what is the level of split? Level of split is of two type, intraepidermal and subepidermal. Intraepidermal is further divided into subcorneal, spinous cell layer and suprabasal layer. Everyone give me a thumbs up if you are clear till here. Vijay, Rajat, Mahima, Shatrughan, everyone give me a thumbs up because this is very, very important. Now, the second thing which they want you people to answer is, what are the examples of different layers? So starting with the subcorneal split, can anybody help me with the example of subcorneal split? The answer here is pemphigus foliaceus. Pemphigus foliaceus is a vesiculobullous disorder which present with the level of clefting at the subcorneal level. Second is staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome and bullous impetigo. These are the infections, bacterial infections which presents with subcorneal cleft. Second is, in which condition you see spinous layer clefting? Can anybody answer this? Spinous cell cleft is seen in viral blisters. For example, varicella, the fluid filled lesions in varicella or herpes simplex. The level of split is spinous cell layer. And the third one, or the third example, is the suprabasal. Can anybody tell me the examples of suprabasal? Yes, very nice all of you. It is pemphigus vulgaris, Dreyer's disease and Hailey-Hailey disease. I hope you all were present in my yesterday's class. I have discussed this point there as well. So pemphigus vulgaris, Dreyer's disease and Hailey-Hailey disease presents with these type of suprabasal cleft. Very nice everyone. So now if we go back to that question, the question which we have discussed is a 50-year-old female present with history of erosions in the buccal mucosa and she presented with the flaccid bulle. Now flaccid means the disease is intraepidermal. Now intraepidermal is pemphigus vulgaris, yes. Bullous pemphigoid, no. Bullous pemphigoid is subepidermal. Staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome, yes, again it is intraepidermal. And toxic shock syndrome is also intraepidermal. Can any one of you tell me one point which differentiate pemphigus vulgaris from staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome? What is that one clue which is given in the question which will help you to exclude Staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome as the answer of this question? Anyone? Vijay, Shatrughan, Mahima, Rajat, can you tell me what is that one point which will help you differentiate the pemphigus vulgaris from staphylococcal? Very nice. The answer is the mucosa involvement. Please remember, in staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome, there is no mucosa involved. And in toxic shock syndrome, there is no mucosa involved. Okay, so this is how you came to the answer of option number one, pemphigus vulgaris. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood how to solve these questions from vesiculobullous disorder. Trick number one, type of bulle. You have two type of bulle which is present, and this is flaccid bulle and tense bulle. Please remember, if flaccid bulle, it means it is intraepidermal, and for intraepidermal I have given you all the examples. Now chalo, let's see some few more questions and I'll get to know whether you people have understood this or not. Which of the following is a subepidermal disease? I think we have done this question yesterday only. Please answer, which of the following is a subepidermal disease? Anyone? Rajat, Vijay, Mahima, Shatrughan, can you answer this question? What is the subepidermal disease? Darius disease, bullous impetigo, pemphigus vulgaris, or bullous pemphigoid? We have discussed it just now. So Deepu, it is not Darius disease. Yes, very nice Vijay. The correct answer here is bullous pemphigoid. Darius disease is an example of congenital acantholytic disorder. Congenital acantholytic disorder, what happens in these conditions? You have deficiency of ATP2A2, which is responsible for a calcium channel. And this will cause abnormal function of desmoglein 3. And this will lead to suprabasal cleft. So in Darius disease, you will see intraepidermal, and in intraepidermal, you will see a suprabasal cleft. I hope this is clear to everyone. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood this point. Now, I think let's check how many of you understand what are the intraepidermal bullae which is seen in the patients. Pemphigoid, pemphigus, dermatitis herpetiformis, or pemphigoid gestationalis. Anyone can answer this question? Anyone can answer this question? This is very important. You will get these type of questions. Which of the following is an intraepidermal bulla? Can you answer it, Deepu, now? Deepu, Rajat, Vijay, Mahima, can anybody answer this question now? A very easy question and will help you, you know, to answer the subsequent questions. Please answer this question. Good. So among the four options given, the only intraepidermal acantholytic disorder is pemphigus group of disorder. Very, very important. It is the pemphigus group of disorder. Okay. Rajat, Karboli, Deepu, Vijay, you all are right. The correct answer is option number two, because in pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, and pemphigoid gestationalis, you will get intraepidermal bulle. So I think everybody is clear with the two tricks. One is the type of bulle, flaccid or tense, and second is level of split. Now coming to the third trick, you should know what are the different clinical presentation. If you know this, you can easily solve the clinical answers. Now what are the different clinical presentation? First, always look for the mucosa involvement. Whether mucosa is involved, yes or no. If mucosa is involved and if the bulla is flaccid, you don't have to think anything. It is pemphigus vulgaris. Okay, it is pemphigus vulgaris if you have mucosa involved. But if there is no mucosa involved, it can be pemphigus foliaceus, it can be bullous pemphigoid, it can be pemphigoid gestationalis, or it can be dermatitis herpetiformis. In all these conditions, you will not have any mucosa involved. So for the clinical diagnosis, please look for one thing: mucosa involved, yes or no. If yes, it should be a case of pemphigus. If no, it can be pemphigus foliaceous, it can be bullous pemphigoid. Now please give me a thumbs up if this question is also clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up if this question is clear. Now before going ahead, I want you to answer this question. Everyone answer this question. A 15-year-old male known case of myasthenia with erythematous shallow erosions with few blisters and scale. Oral mucosa is not involved. Now please use all my three tricks. Trick number one, type of bulla. Trick number two, level of split. And trick number three, clinical presentation. Please try to recall this and now answer the question for me. All of you do this. Very nice. Shavani, Deepu, Karboli, Vijay. Very nice, all of you. I can see a good number of students now. Please answer this question. Use all the tricks. So according to trick number one, can you tell me what is this? They have given you that the patient is having shallow erosions. Shallow erosions means flaccid bulla. So this will tell you that you have flaccid bulla. It means that it is intraepidermal. Trick number two. Trick number two is telling you level of cleft. So here it is shallow erosion, so it is subcorneal. The subcorneal split. And trick number three is clinical feature, no mucosa involved, no mucosa involved. So it becomes a case of pemphigus foliaceus. Very nice, all of you. I think everybody understood. Deepu, Rajat, Vijay, I hope this is a clear question to everyone, that a 50-year-old male, known case of myasthenia with erythematous shallow erosions with few blisters, this is a classical case of pemphigus foliaceus. Now, how does pemphigus foliaceus differs from pemphigus vulgaris? Please remember, in pemphigus vulgaris, you tend to see flaccid bullae, but in pemphigus foliaceus, instead of intact bulla, you tend to see only erosions and crusting. Now, why you do not see any bulla? This is because the level of split is very superficial. It is just below the stratum corneum. So it easily ruptures. It will not remain intact. And that is why instead of intact bullae, you tend to develop scaling and crusting in these individuals, which is mainly present over the seborrheic distribution. Understood this point, everyone? Very nice, Rajat. You are absolutely right. Now, you should know what is the antibody seen in the patient of pemphigus foliaceus. In pemphigus foliaceus, you tend to have antibody which is of IgG type and it is present against desmoglein 1. Now, can you tell me where is desmoglein 1? In which layer of epidermis you see desmoglein? Can anybody answer this question for me? Rajat, Deepu, Vijay, can anybody answer this question for me? In which level of epidermis you tend to see desmoglein 1? Anyone can answer this question. Yes. So Deepu, you are right. It is seen in stratum spinosum. But is it present in the whole thickness of stratum spinosum or only at few places? Can you answer this? Yes. So Vijay, it is not present in the basal layer. It is present on the superficial part of the stratum spinosum. Understood this point? Please give me a thumbs up if all the students understood this point, that desmoglein 1 is present on the superficial part of the stratum spinosum. And that is why you tend to see subcorneal or superficial cleft in the patient of pemphigus foliaceus. Please give me a thumbs up, all the students, if you understood. Please give me a thumbs up. Deepu and Vijay have given me a thumbs up. I want others also to give me a thumbs up. Okay? So the level of splitting in pemphigus foliaceus is in the upper layer, and that is why you develop very shallow erosions. Now, what is happening in patients of pemphigus vulgaris? So please have a look here. I want everyone to concentrate over this picture. Please concentrate over this picture. Now, I will show you, or I will use different colors for the location of the desmoglein. So desmoglein 3, Desmoglein 3 is present somewhere here. Sorry, not desmoglein 3, desmoglein 1 is present here. So it is the desmoglein 1. But where is desmoglein 3 present? Desmoglein 3 present throughout the stratum spinosum, but it is present maximum at the suprabasal layer. That is, in the stratum spinosum cells, which is present immediately above the stratum basal cell. Understood this one? This is a very important concept. If you understood this concept, you can easily make out that where is the level of split in pemphigus vulgaris and in pemphigus foliaceus. Now what happens in pemphigus foliaceus, you have exclusive antibodies against desmoglein 1. So you will only see subcorneal cleft. But in pemphigus vulgaris, you have antibodies against both desmoglein 1 as well as desmoglein 3. But the amount of desmoglein 3 antibodies are more, and that is why you see suprabasal clefting in patients of pemphigus vulgaris. I want thumbs up from everyone if you understood very, very important concept that why you have suprabasal cleft in the patients of pemphigus vulgaris and why you have subcorneal cleft in the patients of pemphigus foliaceus. Now, how to remember that in pemphigus foliaceus you have antibodies against desmoglein 1? So, I will give you a mnemonic. Where is my mnemonic? Yes. So, pemphigus foliaceus and desmoglein 1. Desmoglein 1 is also called as desmoglein 1st. So, you can remember the F of foliaceus and F of 1st. It is very easy to remember. F of foliaceus and F of 1st. So in pemphigus foliaceus, you have antibody against desmoglein 1. Okay? So this is a very important point. And if you understand this, the question becomes very easy. And that is what is given. Now clinical presentation in the patient of pemphigus vulgaris. In pemphigus vulgaris, you will see flaccid bulle. But the surrounding skin means... Surrounding skin means the skin which is present just around the bulle is absolutely normal. Surrounding skin is normal. Now, can you tell me which is that condition where you have surrounding skin involved? Why I am telling you so much in detail about the surrounding skin? Is there any significance of surrounding skin? Can you answer this, Deepu, Vijay, Nabil, Rajat? Anyone can tell me what is the significance of the surrounding skin? Please remember, surrounding skin is erythematous or associated with urticaria in patients of bullous pemphigoid. But surrounding skin is normal in patients of pemphigus vulgaris. So this is a very important differentiating point between pemphigus vulgaris clinically and bullous pemphigoid clinically. Again, give me a thumbs up if you understood this point. This is very, very important for your exam point of view. Understood this point? Please give me a thumbs up. So the difference between the level of split. Okay, very nice. So this is how a patient of pemphigus vulgaris looks like. Now we have few questions for you to solve. Please answer this question for me, all of you. Please answer this question, everyone. The extension of a blister to the adjacent unblistered skin when the pressure is put on the top of the bulla is known as. Please answer this question, everyone. Esbo Hansen sign, Nikolsky sign, Daria sign, or bulla spread sign. Can anybody answer this question for me? Very nice, Deepu. Very nice, you are absolutely right. What about other students? Yes, Vijay is also right. Pramod, Nabil, Shatrughan, Mahima, what about you all? Yes, so the correct answer for this question is Esbo Hansen sign. Now, there are two signs which are very similar to each other. One is bulla spread sign and another is Esbo Hansen sign. Now, what is bulla spread sign? Just have a look over this clinical picture. Now, what do we do in bulla spread sign? We will mark the margins of the bulla. So I hope this is visible to all of you. So we will mark the margins of the bulla and then we will apply the lateral pressure. Okay. On application of the lateral pressure, if the bulla spread, then this is called as bulla spread sign. But what is Esbo-Hansen sign? It is very similar to bulla spread sign. But instead of applying the lateral pressure, you are applying a perpendicular pressure to the bulla. So that is how you differentiate bulla spread sign from the Esbo-Hansen sign. And here they have clearly mentioned that you are applying the pressure from the top. So when you are applying the pressure from above or from the top, it becomes the Esbo-Hansen sign. Clear with this point, Rajat? Understood why this is not bulla spread sign? Please give me a thumbs up, Rajat, if you understood. Because in bulla spread sign, you apply a lateral pressure. And how to remember this? Bulla spread sign or Lud sign, in this you will give a lateral pressure. So L of Lud's and L of lateral will give you an answer. Okay, I think this is a very easy question for all of you to understand, that bulla spread sign and Esbo-Hansen sign, how they are performed. Now, another important point which I want to discuss here only with all of you, just a second. So the another point which I want to discuss is, when you apply the lateral pressure on the bulla, there are two ways the bulla can spread. One is the perpendicular and another way is the round. So if the advancing border is pointed, then it indicates that we are dealing with intraepidermal acantholytic disorder. But if the advancing border is round, it indicates that we are dealing with bullous pemphigoid. Please remember this point. This is a very, very important, that with the help of bulla spread sign, we can differentiate intraepidermal from subepidermal. If the advancing border is conical, it means we are dealing with intraepidermal. The example is pemphigus vulgaris. And if the advancing border is round, it indicates that we are dealing with bullous pemphigoid. So these are all important points or take home messages I want everyone to carry home. Another important sign is the Nikolsky sign. Very, very important for all of you. Please tend to remember what is Nikolsky sign. In Nikolsky sign, we apply a lateral pressure on the skin surrounding the bulla. If there is separation of the skin, it indicates that Nikolsky sign is positive. Now, what is the question which you usually get from Nikolsky sign is this. So please answer this question. Nikolsky sign is positive in all the conditions except. Please answer this question. What is the correct answer? The answer is given above only. The Nikolsky sign is positive in all of the following except. The answer becomes option number 3, that is bullous pemphigoid. So Nikolsky sign is positive in all the intraepidermal acantholytic disorder. Very nice, Deepu, Rajat, Vijay. So this is another question which they can ask you during your preparation time. Okay? Now let's go to the next question. Please answer this question, all of you, for me. Please answer this question, Rajat, Nabil, Deepu, Vijay, Pramod, Mahima. Please answer this question, all of you. 35-year-old female reported with recurrent episodes of oral lesions, area of denuded skin, flaccid bulle. What is the most important bedside investigation? So use my trick. What are the three tricks? Trick number one was type of bulla. So they have given flaccid. If the bulla is flaccid, it means that we are dealing with intraepidermal acantholytic disorder. What is the trick number two? Trick number two is level of split. So level of split is intraepidermal. And trick number three is clinical feature, oral lesions present. And if oral lesions are present, then it becomes a case of pemphigus vulgaris. And in a patient of pemphigus vulgaris, the most important bedside investigation is Zang smear. Please remember, this is a very, very important point. Deepu, it is not skin biopsy. It is Zang smear, which is done to diagnose a case of pemphigus vulgaris. Can anybody tell me, Nabil, Rajat, what do you see in a Zang smear? Anyone, what is the finding of Zang smear? What is that classical entity? So Deepu, Zhang smear is considered to be a bedside investigation because it shows a characteristic cells which is called as acantholytic cells. And if you were present in my yesterday's session, I have told you what are acantholytic cells. These are nothing but the cells of or the keratinocytes of stratum spinosum. Because of the loss of intercellular connections, that is loss of desmoglein, instead of polygonal, they become round in shape. And these round cells are called as acantholytic cell. Understood this point? This is very important. And Rajat, this is not multinucleated cell. This is multinucleated cell. This is multinucleated giant cell, characteristic of viral infection. But these are acantholytic cell. Please try to differentiate this point. This is very important. Okay? So acantholytic cells, these are discrete round cells which are keratinocytes of stratum spinosum. They have attained the round shape because whenever the cell is not attached to any of the surrounding cell, it attains a shape with minimum surface tension, which is the round shape. Okay? So I think this is a very clear picture to all of you, and the bedside investigation is called as Zhang smear. Now please do this question for me, all of you. Question number 20, the next question. Please answer this question. Use the three tricks. Use my trick. Trick number one, trick number two, and trick number three. Trick number one, they have given flaccid bulla. So flaccid bulla means intraepidermal. So the level of split becomes intraepidermal. And the third is clinical feature, oral lesion. So oral lesion present, which means pemphigus vulgaris. So I think now it is very easy to solve the question of vesiculobullous disorder. Deepu, Nabil, Vijay, Karboli, Pramod and Rajat, everyone are right with respect to this question. So pemphigus vulgaris is the answer here. And what is seen, you will see intraepidermal acantholytic or intraepidermal blisters like this. So can you see there is cleft in the stratum spinosum? But here there is intact stratum basal cells. Intact stratum basal cell. Can you tell me why these stratum basal cells are still intact? What is the reason behind intact stratum basal cell? Can anyone answer this for me? Why there is intact stratum basal cell of pemphigus? Yes, the reason is because the stratum basal cell, they are attached to the basement membrane with the help of hemidesmosome. And hemidesmosomes are absolutely normal in the patient of pemphigus vulgaris. Very nice, Vijay and Rajat, you are absolutely right. The cells of stratum basal are intact because they are connected to the basement membrane with the help of hemidesmosome, and hemidesmosomes are absolutely normal in pemphigus vulgaris, and this gives you an appearance which is called as row of tombstone. What is this appearance called as? Row of tombstone. Okay? And this is the row of tombstone where there are different tombstones which are connected. Anyone has any doubts, you can interrupt me. And if there is no doubt, we can go ahead with the discussion of the next question. Everyone give me a thumbs up if you understood this point. Very important for your exam. Chalo. So this is the next question there on your computer screen. Please answer this question for me. 40-year-old male develop persistent oral erosions followed by multiple flaccid bulla on the trunk as well as extremity. Direct examination of the skin, biopsy, immunofluorescence show intercellular IgG. Now please use my trick. Trick number one, trick number two and trick number three. Please use all these tricks. Trick number one, type of bulle, so it is the flaccid bulle. Trick number two, flaccid means intraepidermal cleft. And trick number three, whether the oral mucosa is involved. Yes, you have oral lesions involved. So if these three are present, it becomes a case of pemphigus vulgaris. So even if you are not aware about the immunofluorescence finding, then also you can use or you can answer the question with the help of all these tricks. Is that easy to all of you? I hope you understood this question. Even without knowing the immunofluorescence finding, you can answer this question. The answer is option number one. The immunofluorescence finding in a patient of pemphigus vulgaris shows a classical fishnet pattern. Fishnet pattern. And what is this fishnet pattern? You have IgG which is present in between the cells of stratum spinosum. So this will give you a fishnet or a chicken wire appearance. Please give me a thumbs up, everyone, if you understood this, or at least write yes if you understood, so that we can go ahead with the next question. Understood, everyone? Yes, good. Now, please, I have few questions for you. Before going ahead, I'll give you few questions, which is again very important. And these questions are on the variants. So what are the different variants and what are the questions? So please answer these questions for me, all of you. Please answer this question, everyone. The rarest variety of pemphigus is, what is the answer of this question? Very nice. Very, very nice. Now, please remember, now pemphigus has different varieties. And depending upon these varieties, so I will give you an example. What are the different type of, so pemphigus have various variant, and these are the variants which are given in the question. So in pemphigus vulgaris, you have pemphigus vegetans as the variant, and for pemphigus foliaceus, there are three variant. One is drug-induced pemphigus, second is endemic pemphigus, and third is pemphigus erythematosus. So there is one variant of pemphigus vulgaris and three variant of pemphigus foliaceus. Now pemphigus vulgaris is considered to be the most common variety, and pemphigus vegetans is considered to be the most rarest variety. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood till here. How does pemphigus vegetans present? It presents with vegetative growth. Can you see vegetative growth? So instead of bulla, instead of flaccid bulla, it presents with a vegetative growth over the flexures. For example, axilla, groin, or intermammary area. So pemphigus vegetans, which is a variant of pemphigus vulgaris, is considered to be the most rarest variety of pemphigus. Okay? So I think this question is easy for all of you, that which is the rarest variety. So the answer here becomes option number 2, that is pemphigus vegetans. And I think majority of you are right with respect to this question. Now, which drug is most commonly implicated in drug-induced pemphigus? So if you remember, drug-induced pemphigus was a variety of pemphigus foliaceus. So it is a variant of pemphigus foliaceus. The question is, which is the most common drug which is involved in the drug-induced pemphigus? Very nice, Vijay. Very nice, Deepu. You are absolutely right. What about other students? Pavan, Karboli, Rajat, what about you? What is the answer of this question? Very nice. The correct answer of this question is option number 1, penicillamine. So drug-induced pemphigus, the most common drug involved is penicillamine, and other drugs are iodide, penicillin, phenolphthalein, phenytoin, and thiazide diuretic. I hope this is clear to everyone. Very, very important question. Now, can anybody tell me, in drug-induced pemphigus, you will see antibody against which component? Can you tell me what antibody and what is the antigen against which you see antibody in drug-induced pemphigus? Can anybody answer this question for me? Pavan, Vijay, Deepu, Rajat, Karboli, can you answer this question? What antibody is present in the patients of drug-induced pemphigus? Try answering it. Whether you don't know, please try to answer it. Anyone? Which antibody is seen in the patient of drug-induced pemphigus? Please remember, there is no antibody. There is no antibody in the patient of drug induced. Yes, very nice. There is no antibodies. What is the reason behind the development of blisters? The reason is biochemical interaction. What happens? The drugs consist of a thiol group. And there is also a thiol group which is attached to desmoglein. Now, this thiol groups, they interact with each other, causing their separation, and hence it causes drug-induced pemphigus. So please remember, there is no antibodies in a drug-induced pemphigus patient. Please give me a thumbs up if this is also clear to all of you. Very important for your understanding for solving the questions of vesiculobullous disorder. Now moving to next question, which of the following is the commonest association of paraneoplastic pemphigus? Can you tell me which is the commonest association of paraneoplastic pemphigus? Chronic lymphocytic leukemia, thymoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, or Castleman's disease? So you should know what is paraneoplastic pemphigus and how does it differs. Very nice, Vijay. I can see answers already coming from a few of the students. Vijay, Deepu, very nice. What about you, Pavan? Anybody else want to answer this question? Rajat, Karboli. What about you, Pramod? Meenu, can anybody answer this? Yes, the correct answer here is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Now, what is this? What is paraneoplastic pemphigus? So, paraneoplastic pemphigus, it is a variant of pemphigus which presents in association with an underlying malignancy. What all malignancies are associated? We have total 4 malignancy: non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, Castleman's disease, and thymoma. These are the 4 malignancies which are associated with paraneoplastic pemphigus, and the most common is the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Please remember, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is the most common association. Now, can you tell me against which component you will see antibodies in a patient of paraneoplastic pemphigus? Against which component? Can you answer this question? Karboli, can you answer this question? Sahana, Pavan, what is that component against which you will see presence of antibody in a paraneoplastic pemphigus? In normal pemphigus vulgaris, you have antibodies against desmoglein 3 and desmoglein 1. Is there any difference in paraneoplastic pemphigus? Anyone? Yes, the answer is yes. You will see antibody against the Plakin group of family. Plakin group means, what do you mean by Plakin group? Plakin group means desmoplakin, placoglobin, and placophyllin. What are these? These are the intracellular component. These are the intracellular component of the desmosome. So please remember, in paraneoplastic pemphigus, along with antibodies against desmoglein 3, desmoglein 1, you will see antibodies against the Plakin group of family also. Please give me a thumbs up, everyone, if you understood a very, very important topic for your exam. Paraneoplastic pemphigus, the most common malignancies, as well as the type of, the antibodies which is associated here. So very nice, Deepu, if you understood, this is very, very important for your exam. Chalo, let's move to the next question. And where is the next question? Yes, so this is the next question. Can you answer this? What is Fogo-cell vagum? What is Fogo-cell vagum? Can you answer this question for me? Pavan, Vijay, Deepu, Karboli, can you answer this question for me? What is Fogo-cell vagum closely resembles? Very nice, everyone. Very nice. Fogo-cell vagum closely resembles pemphigus vulgaris, foliaceus, pemphigus vegetans, and pemphigus erythematosus. Okay, so I think this is clear. Nothing more to understand here. So Fogo-cell vagum, it is a variety of pemphigus foliaceus. I'll show you how does it looks clinically. So Fogo-cell vagum, it is nothing but another name of endemic pemphigus foliaceus. Now, endemic pemphigus foliaceus is very common in the southern American states, for example, Brazil or Mexico. Now, here, why it is called as endemic? Because it is initially thought to occur secondary to a black fly. And the term fogo salvagum is used because it gives a burnt appearance to the skin, which resembles the wildfire of the forest. So I hope you understood what you mean by fogo salvagum and why it is called as endemic pemphigus foliaceus, because it used to occur previously in the secondary to the bite of the black fly, and because of the burnt appearance of the skin, it is called as fogo salvagum, which means wildfire. Okay, so I think this is clear to all of you. Now there is one more variety which is called as pemphigus erythematosus. It has features of both pemphigus foliaceus and lupus erythematosus. So it will present with malar rash of lupus erythematosus and scaling and crusting over the seborrheic distribution similar to that of pemphigus foliaceus. Okay? And there is a variety of pemphigus erythematosus which is called as senior Usher syndrome. Please try to remember all these names: endemic pemphigus foliaceus, pemphigus erythematosus and senior Usher syndrome. They can be asked in your exams, and we have discussed few questions related to that as well. Now moving to the next question. So this is the next question. Please answer this question. Senior Usher syndrome is a variety of, we have just now discussed this. So I think a very easy question, it is a variant of pemphigus erythematosus. Okay? Any confusion? No. Very nice. Good. Very nice, Vijay, Deepu, happy. Karboli, very nice everyone. Very nice. Chalo. Can you answer this question for me? Can anybody answer this question for me? Rarely associated with oral ulcers, classically shown IgG in the basement membrane zone or direct immunofluorescence, usually present in the 6th and the 7th decade and has a good prognosis if treated with high dose of corticosteroids. What will be the correct answer here? Very nice, Deepu, Pavan, very nice. You have to give me a true statement. So Pavan is right, only Pavan is right for this question. It is rarely associated with oral erosion. No. If you remember my trick number 3, oral erosion is frequently seen in patients of pemphigus vulgaris. IgG is not against the basement membrane zone. It is present in the intercellular space. Okay. Pemphigus vulgaris usually presents in a young individual, that is in the middle-aged or young individual. And only correct answer is option number 4, that it has a good prognosis when treated with corticosteroids. So what is the treatment modality available in the market for the treatment of pemphigus? It is the oral steroids, which is the mainstay of the treatment. You can give it in a conventional manner or in a pulse manner. Now what do you mean by conventional or pulse? Conventional means you will give daily dose of steroid. Daily dose of steroid is given in conventional. But what happens when you give daily dose of steroids, there is lot of steroidal side effects. And because of lot of steroidal side effects, you have to stop the drug in between. So for preventing those steroidal side effects, we have started the pulse therapy where you will give high doses at a regular interval. For example, monthly interval. You will give high dose of steroids 3 days in a month or 4 days in a month. That's it. Okay. And then again repeating the same dose in the next month. So this is how you can prevent the spread of the disease, that is giving the oral steroid. Now you have new drug which is available, and that is rituximab. It works against CD20 receptors which are present on B cells. So when CD20 receptors are affected, it causes destruction of B cells. When there is no B cells, there is no plasma cell and there is no autoantibody formed. So I think this question is clear to all of you. And this was the last question of the today's session. I hope you have enjoyed this question. Everyone give me a thumbs up if you have enjoyed the last question of the today's session. That is, what is the treatment available for the patients of pemphigus vulgaris. It is the oral steroids which is available. You can give it in conventional manner or you can give in a pulse therapy manner. So I hope you have enjoyed the today's session. We have good number of students today in our class. If you like the class, please subscribe to the YouTube channel, that is Let's Crack Neet PG. Give a thumbs up to my review and please don't forget to use the bell icon. If you want to subscribe any course on an academy, please use my referral code, that is CHESHTA10. Please use my referral code CHESHTA10 for subscription to any of the course of an academy. And please tell your friends about this YouTube channel. You have a lot more things coming up for you in this YouTube with respect to dermatology. So crack dermatology, Neet PG with me, Dr. CHESHTA. I'll be live daily at 8 p.m. with interesting sessions for all of you. Till then, take care. Good night. Bye-bye. Study home and study hard.